Penguin Random House presents Emerging India, Economics, Politics and Reforms by Bimal Jalan, read by Abhishek Sharma. Bimal Jalan is one of India's well-known economists. He was governor of the Reserve Bank of India from 1997 to 2003. Demitting office on his nomination to the Upper House of Parliament by the President for distinguished service to the country. He has held several top positions in the Ministries of Finance and Industry and in the Planning Commission. He was also chairman of the Economic Advisory Council to the Prime Minister and represented India on the boards of the IMF and the World Bank. He was educated at Presidency College, Calcutta, and Cambridge and Oxford Universities. His books include India's Economic Crisis, The Way Ahead, written in 1991. India's Economic Policy, Preparing for the 21st Century, written in 1996. India's Economy in the New Millennium, written in 2002. The Future of India, written in 2006. And, as editor, The Indian Economy, Problems and Prospects, revised edition in 2004. Emerging India, Economics, Politics and Reforms, written by Bimal Jalan. To Mahira and Ayushman, Ananmay and Tanay. Yes, you can. Preface. This book is different from my earlier ones. This is a collection of selected papers, lectures and some unpublished notes from personal archives. Most of the papers selected for publication in this book relate to the period 1990 to 2010, with the exception of three unpublished notes from 1974 to 75 on the reform of the industrial and import licensing policy. The papers brought together in this book have been chosen to provide a broad overview of the evolution of India's politics, economics, governance and economic reforms over the past two decades and their implications for the future. I should mention that papers in this book are a relatively small part of a larger collection of old papers in the archives. The larger collection, containing more than 450 papers, has been passed on to the library of the National Council of Applied Economic Research, or NCAER, New Delhi, for use by staff members of NCAER for research and reference purposes, subject to applicable copyright rules. In addition to my own papers, notes and memos, the collection of papers in the NCAER archive contains copies of published articles by several eminent economists and experts on India's past, present and future. These articles, spread over the past five decades, provide a most useful account of developments in the theory and practice of economic policy making in developing societies, including India, after the end of the colonial era. I owe a deep debt of gratitude to several persons who helped me at various stages of the project. Papers in my personal archives were written at different points of time over a long period, in different contexts, and covered a large variety of subjects. The task of preparing this volume and selecting papers of contemporary interest turned out to be much more difficult than I had originally anticipated. I am particularly grateful to Satish Chaudhary for his meticulous work in preparing the manuscript for publication, to B.B. Chand and his team at the NCAER Library for downloading numerous articles and scanning them for consideration, and to K.D. Sharma for his organizational and other help. I deeply appreciate the expert advice received from Shashanka Bhide on the selection of papers whenever I asked for it, and to Ms. Anuradha Basin for copy editing and preparing the manuscript. I am especially grateful to Udayan Mitra at Penguin for his invaluable help and guidance at different stages of the book's publication. Ameya Nagarajan did the final editing of the book within a very short period. I am thankful to her for her meticulous work. Written by Bimal Jalan in August 2011. Introduction. Just a year or two ago, India's reputation as both a democracy and a global emerging power was at its peak. Today, with daily reports of widening corruption, misgovernment and public despair about the working of India's politics, the picture has changed dramatically. India's reputation seems to have swung from that of a land of great opportunity to that of a country with an uncertain future. The change in perceptions of the working of India's democracy and its economic prospects is, of course, nothing new. In the mid-1980s also, from 1984 to 85 to 1990 to 91, India had registered a rate of growth of more than 8% per annum, and soon thereafter, in 1991, India went through one of its worst economic crises. With two short-lived governments in the 2 years prior to the crisis, there was also a big question mark about the country's political future. In the light of current concerns about India's prospects and the past history of sharp swings in India's fortunes, I have tried, in this volume, to bring together a set of papers on India's past, present, and future. Most of these papers were written over the last 20 years, with the exception of three short notes from the mid-1970s regarding the need for reforms in the import and industrial licensing policy to boost growth. The primary message of these essays, as I look back, is simply that in the past 20 years, unlike the period before, India's capacity to grow faster than ever before and eliminate poverty has increased substantially because of certain positive changes in its comparative advantage in relation to other countries. However, for India to seize the opportunities that lie ahead, it is essential to bring about reforms in the working of our politics and administration. The main areas of concern in the light of recent events are basically two: the growing disjuncture between economics and politics, and the emergence of a public-private dichotomy in the growth trajectory. There is simply no doubt that, in recent years, as the economy has become vibrant, politics has become more fragmented and messier. Most of us, as observers of the Indian scene, are, of course, familiar with these developments, such as the diminishing accountability of the executive to parliament, rising corruption, the preponderance of criminals in politics, and the disproportionate power of small regional parties in multi-party coalitions. Unfortunately, while these unsavory political developments are well known and dominate the media space, there is much appreciation of the urgent need for political reforms to strengthen accountability, reduce the scope for corruption, and reverse the incentives for small parties to destabilize coalitions. Another core issue with multiple dimensions that needs to be resolved is what can be best described as the growing public-private dichotomy in economic life. It is a striking fact that growth is now occurring largely outside the public sector. India has the distinction of having a large number of dollar billionaires. The assets of the top 20 billionaires are more than 20% of India's gross domestic product, or better known as GDP. This is larger than the share of the GDP contributed by the entire agricultural sector, on which more than 600 million Indian citizens are dependent for survival. No wonder economic disparities are rising and becoming a major source of concern and discontent in several parts of the country. There is also a marked deterioration in public administration at all levels, particularly in the provisions of essential public services in the fields of education, health, water, and transport. As we look ahead, it is important to ask ourselves, how long can this dichotomy in the performance in the economy of the public and private sectors continue without causing severe turbulence and affecting growth? The present volume contains 25 papers divided into four sections. Section 1 is on political issues that require urgent attention if India is to maintain its position as an emerging global economic power of the 21st century. This section is based on papers and lectures delivered during the period when I had the privilege of observing the work of Parliament from inside as a non-party nominated member of the Rajya Sabha from 2003 to 2009. A lot of what is said in these papers has been discussed in an earlier book named India's Politics, A View from the Backbench, Viking Penguin, 2007. The worrisome developments in the working of India's politics have undoubtedly become even more pronounced in the 4 years since that book was published. Section 2 deals with India's economic policy and prospects, particularly whether the changes witnessed in India's performance after the deep crisis of 1991 are likely to last or wither away in the event of unforeseen global or domestic developments. The answer to this question, in my view, is that India now has the capacity to realize its potential, provided we avoid over-exuberance and take timely measures to exploit India's emerging strengths in technology, skill-based services, and high productivity industries. Section 3 is on money, finance, and banking. Most of the papers in this section are based on talks and discussions at conferences held at central banks and professional institutions during the period I served as Governor of the Reserve Bank of India, or RBI, during 1997 to 2003. Several of these papers capture the essence of the position taken by India on contemporary financial and banking issues in international institutions, such as the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, and the Bank for International Settlement. These papers may be of interest in our understanding of the reasons why and how India was able to avoid the contagious and adverse effects of the US and global financial crisis of 2008. The final section provides a historical perspective on India's economic reforms launched in 1991, in the midst of a severe crisis. An important issue which deserves consideration is the reason why India delayed comprehensive industrial and trade reforms for so long, when the need for such reforms had been evident for quite some time. It is hoped that some of the papers here, including a short article.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.